Welcome to Easy LM, Learning Simplified. My name is Ruth, and today we are going to be looking at the topic Energy Changes in Physical and Chemical Properties. We are going to be looking at enthalpy of combustion. So you look at how we are able to burn substances and fuels, and then choosing also the correct type of fuel. So when we are measuring enthalpy changes, we usually use an instrument called calorimeter, and it's usually insulated to reduce heat loss to the surrounding. And you notice you're going to be doing different enthalpies in the course of this topic, and some of the values you get at the end of like a calculation or a practical will have a difference in comparison to the theoretical value. This is because there are some sources of errors in these reactions, and one of the sources of errors is heat loss to surrounding. So even as you are measuring the heat change or the temperatures, you notice some of the heat is not accounted for. So heat loss to surrounding is one of the errors. There's also absorption of heat by the vessel, that is the calorimeter. So sometimes that is not also accounted for even in our calculations. So there are different types of heat changes. We are going to consider enthalpy of combustion or heat of combustion, which we are going to discuss today. We have enthalpy of neutralization, enthalpy of solution, enthalpy of precipitation, and enthalpy of displacement. Some books put these two together, but you're going to separate so that you can go to see the difference, and then enthalpy of formation, which relates to the Hess law. So for today, we also mentioned standard enthalpies. When we hear standard enthalpies, it means enthalpies that are measured under standard conditions, which are in one molar concentration solutions, gases that are at one atmospheric pressure. So if substances are in their standard states, we say that they are at one atmospheric pressure and 298 temperature at one molar. So we start with heat of combustion. So you can be taught to define what heat of combustion is. So this is the heat change when one mole, this is now the molar heat of combustion, one mole of a substance is completely burnt in oxygen. Some books which talk about completely burnt in air. So remember, the active part of air is oxygen. So that's why they say completely burnt in air. So even if you say it, it's still going to be okay. It's completely burnt in oxygen at one atmospheric pressure. So the changes are usually negative because heat is evolved. So that is the reason why some of these fuels are used as fuels, because they give off heat, which is used for heating substances. So the final answer must always be negative. This is one of the things that must be checked when marking is being or points are being awarded. An example of heat of combustion is when you burn carbon in air, we produce carbon dioxide, and 394 kilojoules of energy is given off in one mole, and you can see the values are negative. We usually call this the thermochemical equation. We'll be doing a lot of thermochemical equation, not just a normal chemical equation that is balanced, but also with the heat change, so it makes it a thermochemical equation. When we are calculating the heat evolved, we usually use this formula, the specific heat capacity, which we'll present by C. Most of the time, it's usually 4.2, either kilojoules per gram, per Kelvin, or the units can be given differently. So your work is to ensure that they are correct units in regards to the other values in the formula. And then times the mass, and we call this one mass of the solution, or in this case, mass of the solution or surrounding. So surrounding solution, it has to be in solution state. So in combustion, we'll be measuring, we're using the mass of the water that is being heated. So because that is how we are able to tell if a certain substance produces a lot of heat or not, depending on how it burns that water. So we will convert the mass of the solution from the volume to mass, and since the density is 1 gram per centimeter cubed, so we use this as our conversion. And then the temperature rise, we're going to also mention that temperature rise, but we have already mentioned that the value will be negative. It tells you that it's going to rise, not lower. So let's look at a certain setup. So ethanol was burnt in the spirit lamp, and then it hit 100 centimeters cubed of water. So the initial temperature of the water was 22.5, the final was 50.5, so the change was 28.0. So you notice in our formula we have kelvins, so we do not convert 28.0 to degrees Celsius to Kelvin, but if you convert 22.5 degrees Celsius into Kelvin, which will give you 295.5, and if we convert 50.5 degrees Celsius into Kelvin, which will give you 323.5. These are in both in Kelvin. If you do the subtraction, you get 28. That's the reason why we do not go ahead to convert 28 into degrees into Kelvin. It's already in Kelvin. Then the mass of the water is 100 grams. You get 100 grams by saying if 1 gram, we know the density of water is 1 gram per centimeter cubed, which is 1 gram is in 1 centimeter cubed. So what about 100 centimeters cubed, which gives you 100 grams. So that's how we directly convert the mass from the volume into mass. And then we also have the mass of the ethanol. So the ethanol is written as C2. H5OH. This is the formula. You need it especially when you calculate the number of moles. So before heating it was 30.46, after it was 30.06, which gave us this difference. So we start calculating the heat evolve. So heat change is going to be specific heat capacity times the mass of water times the change in temperature. So this is the same as you use 4.2 kilojoules per gram per Kelvin times the mass of the solution now is 100 grams times change in temperature, which is 28, which will give us 11,760, and it's kilojoules. And then we need to calculate the number of moles. This is just how you calculate the part A of the question. Part B is molar. So we need the moles of ethanol used. So moles of ethanol used is equals to mass over molar mass. So the mass you've already been given, which is 0.40 grams. For the molar mass, we need to calculate. This will be C2, so we have 2 carbons, so it's 12 times 2 plus 6 hydrogen, so 1 times 6. These are the atomic numbers, plus 1 oxygen, which is 16, which gives us 46. So the moles will be 0.4 divided by 46, which gives us 0.009 moles. So we will say if 0.009 moles produces 11,760 kilojoules, what about 1 mole? So we want per mole. So 11,760 divided by 0.009 moles, which gives us this value. And do not be surprised with the value, and it's per mole, and remember it's negative, especially if you have used the correct unit. So that the reason why the value is very big is because we just use the units that we are given. The next in the questions, you always be given the specific heat capacity depending on what they want. So you can still convert this into joules depending on what you have been given. So next, let's look at the fuels. How do you choose the best fuel? So fuels are usually compounds which produce high heat of combustion. They can be solids such as charcoal, wood, and coal, and they can also be liquid such as ethanol and gasoline, just like you've seen in the experiment ethanol. They can also be gaseous such as methane and water. So like methane, we know some of these gases are used for cooking. So when it comes to calorific value, it's the energy content of our fuel. So this is the heat evolved when a given mass of a fuel is completely burnt in oxygen. Sometimes fuel can undergo incomplete combustion, and if it undergoes incomplete combustion, it means it reduces the energy content and it can also lead to pollution. So we have another concept called the heating value. This is the amount of given energy given out when a mass or unit volume of a fuel is completely burnt in oxygen. So when we are calculating the heat value, we usually take the heat change of a certain fuel, we divide it by the molar mass. So you can get the heating value, which helps us to choose a good fuel. So fuel pollution is commonly caused by the internal combustion of agent. So when fuel burns completely in water, it forms carbon dioxide and water only in an ideal condition. If it does so incompletely, it forms carbon dioxide, which can cause pollution because it's very poisonous. In some cases, nitrogen and sulfur oxidize to form sulfur dioxide and nitrogen dioxide, which form acid rain, in which causes like issues with buildings and trees and also animals. It also causes fuel additives like tetraethyl lead. When it's added to petrol to enhance burning efficiency, it produces volatile lead compounds in the exhaust fume. So lead is very poisonous because it affects the nervous system. So how do you choose the best fuel? Choose the best fuel by identify the heating values needs to be high, and then the rate of combustion or the heat of combustion. Also the availability, if it's locally available or not, or it's expensive, and also the ease of transportation. Also, we look at the ease of storage, and finally, its environmental effect or impact. So that's how you consider when you are considering to choose a good fuel. So that's it for today. We'll look at the next enthalpy in the next lesson. So see you then.